Hi there, ladies and gents. It's Dan from Adventure More UK. Welcome to another episode of my podcast, Catch You on the Flip Side. Today's special guest is an adventurer, a writer, and also a speaker. It is Mr. Tim Millikin. How are you, my friend?
Hello. Nice to be here, Dan. Thank you for inviting me on.
Oh, no problem, dude. It's been... First of all, I just want to say thanks to James. For people that don't know, James got us in touch. A friend of mine who was on one of my last podcasts, so I appreciate him getting us in together. Now, obviously, you've been doing a lot of things over the last few years. There's a few things I want to talk about. There is the main sort of point in which I want to bring up, but that's kind of the main bulk of it. But first of all, I just want to talk about, I talk about this with a lot of my guests, is like adventure. Was it kind of in your blood, like when you were a kid? Is it something you wanted to do, or is it just came naturally?
It's a good question. It wasn't in my blood in a way that, you know, I came from any degree of sporting background. You know, I was relatively unfit when I was younger, and the idea of cycling 10 miles would be out of the question. But as I grew up and as I tried different things, especially in my 20s, like the element of freedom was a big thing for me, and being in the outdoors and having that freedom. And then when I turned 26, I guess I went on my first ever proper trip, which was a backpacking trip to Australia. And I think that opened the doors to me to see what adventure could really be like. And in that trip, I did a lot of hitchhiking and cycle touring, and it sort of opened my eyes to what travel and what adventure could really be about. But previously to that, I had real no experience. I was more of a, you know, I used to work in television, and I was more of a party scene than an adventurer. I'd spend all my money out and out in Camden and things like that.
Oh yeah, no, fair enough. Yeah, like, because it's interesting, like, to see how, like, because people obviously come from different backgrounds. People sort of fall into the adventure sort of scene, and some people it's just built into them from a young age. And just for myself, like, it just seem like that for me. I'm that kind of latter one, where it seems like I've always been involved in, you know, ever since I could probably walk, I was out in the woods, I was out camping, you know. And for me, as people know, you know, I joined the military at 16, did 8 years in the military. So adventure was, and sort of being outdoors was always a big thing for me. And as I said, sport was always a big thing. Did you do any sport at school, or would you kind
of? No, I played football very badly. I guess, you know, when I was very young, so when I was maybe 10 to maybe even younger, 8 to 13, 8 to 14, every summer my parents used to take our family on this trip to Butte to this activity centre called Adventure International. It's still there now, it's like an old castle. And so it normally does residential school trips for kids, but we'd go as a family. They'd open up in the summers for families, and we'd go. Yeah. And at that young age, I probably got the first taste of doing things like abseiling and canoeing and hiking and orienteering and coasteering. And, you know, you do all these little taster activities. And I think that little experience did stick in there. Like it did, whilst I then went through my teenage and early adult life not really doing anything. But when I turned into my mid-20s and that adventure life came into it, I think those experiences did stick. And I think that's probably where the seed ideally germinated from.
Yeah. No, I'm the same. Like I went to these camps you do at school. I went first in primary school, exactly the same. Like we went away and did trips, doing walking, kayaking and all that sort of thing. And I absolutely loved it. And that's, I think, again, what got me into it. I kind of remembered that from when I was a kid. Was there anything available to you, as in the sense of like jobs or occupations, like, or did you always want to kind of get into the outdoors, or was there anything else you really wanted to do?
No, I've had a very storied career history. When my degree was in film production, I studied at Lincoln, so I always wanted to work in film, and that was my primary motivation when I was younger. I think just because I enjoyed watching films more than anything else. You know, people, like when we were growing up, me and my friendship group, we kind of got pushed towards university, and we kind of had to go, hey, you got to go to university, it's the thing you do. So I was like, okay, well, I'll go and study film then. It's almost like a minor act of rebellion. I don't want to study anything real. I'll go study film. So, you know, I worked in the film industry for 5 years after university, and I was very lucky, and I worked on some amazing productions. But it wasn't until I got bored of that and quite got, I found that career industry quite stale, that I stopped. And that's when I went on to Australia. And that's when the world of the outdoors really opened up for me. And it was all sort of self-made trips in the early days, including the big round the world bike ride. And then that, after the bike ride, that's what really changed things for me. So I'd had this moment of realization that that's what I want to do. And that's the industry that I'm really passionate, I really care about. So following that, I now am very lucky enough to get paid to work in the outdoors, mainly guiding bicycle trips or bushcraft trips or survival trips and things like that. But I guess you go through many career changes in life, and now I'm in the one that I think fits me the best right now.
Yeah, yeah, no, absolutely. I completely agree, because I'm the same. Like I, as I said, I mentioned being in the military. I then left the military and became a telecoms engineer. That was my background, so everything to do with, you know, going to people's houses and fitting phone lines, that was my bread and butter. But I soon got bored of it. I really got bored of it, and I wanted to go back to that being outside, and I love walking and stuff and hiking, and I thought, well, what can I do? So that's when, for me, I did, as we found out previously to this, like, we both work for the same company, and as you say, we both taught bushcraft. So that was my first insight to the outdoor sort of industry, working for bushcraft, and absolutely loved it. I love, and
me too.
For people that know, it was amazing. And for people that know me quite well, like my best friends, my close friends, and my family, a lot of them were probably thinking, like, for me, because when I left the military, I had a lot of, I won't say issues, but I had the same problems as a lot of ex-military people do, or veterans do, with PTSD and depression and drinking and stuff like that. So when I said to them that I want to do a career in the outdoors and work with children, people thought I was crazy. Like, people thought I was mad. They're like, how can you, as a person who's come from that background, go and work with children? And do you know what? I've been doing it, you know, close to 9-10 years now, and I absolutely love it. It's the best thing in the world, best job in the world, I think. I know everyone will say their industry is the best or their job is the best, but I can't think of anything better than, and it sounds cliche, but teaching a future generation about whatever it may be, you know, especially things about the outdoors and being active and stuff like that. And I think that's a great thing.
Yeah, it's so important as well these days, you know, because now more than ever with COVID, but previously to that, you know, you're taking kids out from inner city London who have never seen a woodland before, and they're asking permission if they can go and run. And you're like, this is a safe environment, you're safe, we've fenced off, there's first aid people here, go and be a kid. It's really important. And now they get that through these kinds of works that we do. I think it's really, really important.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously, as we said before we came on, is, you know, we're a similar age, and I think we're from a generation where we didn't have to ask about that. We kind of just I don't know about you, but when I came home from school, I did my homework, had my tea, and then I go out and play in the garden, or there's like a woodlands in the back of my house. I go and play in there until the street lights came on, and then I come home, I come in.
Yeah.
And that's how I was brought up. And I think it's very different nowadays. And as I've said, we both work in this, you know, in the same industry. And I feel like children aren't allowed to be children anymore. There's too many restrictions, I think, no matter where they come from.
Too much fear.
Yeah, there is too much fear. And I feel like I don't want to say that we're bringing up a generation of softer children or softer, you know, softer generation, but it does kind of seem like that. I've noticed that with kids that I've been you know, teaching, or like had groups over the years. But at the same time, I don't know if you notice this, when you've got certain children from certain areas of the country, for instance, for me, I could have children, actually no, because I'll go back to my last job before pre-COVID. I was working down near Bath, and we'd get kids from London, and you can tell they're from, you know, inner city kids, but then you get kids from the Cotswolds and stuff like that, or kids that are from Wales, and they live in, you know, on farms and stuff like that. And it seems like, even though they might be the same age, they're very different children. Do you ever notice stuff like that?
Yes, you can really tell, just their behaviour and almost their mindset sometimes. And it's a bit of a generalisation to say every kid from inner city London is never seen a woodland and they're scared of the big city. That's not true. But there is a generalisation there. I think it's correct that you go see some groups of kids from some areas will be very very different than other schools. Likewise, if you work with a private school and you work with a public school, you can automatically see the difference in terms of their education and often their behaviour as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And I can totally agree, absolutely agree. First thing I want to talk about your adventures is where you say you went to Australia. Was that in a sort of personal capacity, as in was it basically a trip, what we call as a working holiday visa and traveling and stuff like that, or was it more of a professional kind of
no, that was a full-on working holiday visa. It was time I was working for a TV studio in Camden. It was amazing fun, but it was also we're going out 3 or 4 nights a week partying, and after 2 years of that I'd kind of decided I needed a change and a break, so I moved to Australia on a very common kind of working holiday visa, and then realized I didn't have any money and went to work in Australia, worked on farms, worked on courgette farms, chili farms, mango farms, still the farms, I think. Don't remember the outdoors. I just work on farms.
I know what you mean. I've done exactly the same. I did it in my late, basically last chance salute before I turned 30. So I know exactly what you did. One of the things I was going to ask you about, you obviously one of the first things that you did was you obviously do a lot of bicycle touring, and you cycled from, was it Noosa to Brisbane? Was it Noosa to Brisbane? Yeah.
That was amazing. So I'll start a story a little way before that. And before I did the bicycle touring, I was on a bus in Australia and I was looking out the window of this bus and I was seeing all these villages go by and I'm like, what is that? And I was really curious because all I was doing in Australia was generally going on the bus, going to the hostel, going to the bar, seeing the tourist thing, and then doing it all over again. And I was just partying with Europeans and I was kind of felt like I was missing the real Australia. So on that bus, I was realized that what I was going to actually do is I'm going to cycle home from Australia. So I had my little notebook and I wrote, cycle home from Australia, possible rebirth, 9 months, Australia to England. And I thought, yeah, that's a really good idea, Tim. Then on that bus journey, maybe not the exact one, but maybe in a month's time, my girlfriend flew out to see me and then we were going to be in Australia together. And I picture the idea that when we were living in Cairns, that we were going to, which is in the top northeast, that we'll cycle to a music festival in Brisbane. And she's like, no, we're not doing that, you're mad. So I was like, I looked at like all the routes and the weathers and she's like, it's 40 degrees, Tim, and there's no shops anywhere. So I thought we could do it. She was a lot more hesitant. Bless her. She still did a really amazing trip with me. But at the time, she was a lot more hesitant because she'd never done it. And I'd never done it either. But I just probably had more stupid mindset, perhaps. Machismo, maybe. And so we settled that we'll do a smaller trip and a trial trip to see if we could cycle back from Australia. And that trip was from Noosa to Brisbane. And it was amazing because it was the first sense of complete bicycle freedom. Like we could go wherever we wanted and see anything we wanted and sleep anywhere we wanted. And we bought bikes we spent about 100 quid on 2 bikes. And then we just got a milk crate and cable tied it to the back and then put our backpacks in it and then just started cycling. And the backpack would just fall off all the time. It was an awful setup.
Yeah, that's
but it did give us the first taste of cycle touring, which is really fun.
Yeah, that's definitely experience. So after you'd done, was it 6 days you'd cycled for that?
Yeah, it was about 7 days. Yeah, maybe it's longer. It was maybe 10 days potentially.
Okay. So after you'd done that trip, did that kind of, what made you sort of think about after that trip going and doing sort of cycling home? Because obviously, you didn't end up doing it. Is there a reason why, or is it just not? What you didn't think it was for you?
Whilst the trip was amazing and it was fun, it also brought home a lot of realities of two people living together. And it was only a short time. but we crashed a lot, even on those, you know, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 days. We realized that actually when we were in this situation, we didn't often get on that well. So the idea to cycle back was then shelved. A, we didn't really have the money because whilst we were both on work and holiday visas, we weren't really working. We kind of were spending the money that we earned to travel around Australia because we wanted to see the country we were in.
Yeah.
So we didn't really have the money to cycle back. And also we just needed to recover maybe from that first trip. And we decided to see Australia by car, and we did recover. The relationship did recover, and we were then able to fly home from Australia. But the idea didn't leave us. And then we got home, the idea grew, and that was to not only cycle from Australia to England, but cycle around the world from Reading to Reading, Reading in England to Reading in America.
Well, that's the obviously your big trip that you did. I want to talk a little bit about
Okay.
that
Yeah.
in a little bit. But there's one thing I read about you that you did a trip in, was it in Germany to somewhere in Germany to Vienna, Austria.
Yes.
Was that like another trial run, as you
That
call
was
it?
exactly that. That was a trial run. Yeah, that was a more that was a we'd learned a lot from the first trip. So we'd learned how before we did the first ever trip, the Noosa to Brisbane, we didn't even know there was a thing called cycle touring. We just wanted to see Australia by bike, using the bike as a method of seeing the country, interacting with the environment, and it's really cheap. Okay, so that was primarily one of the reasons. Then when we'd got home and we'd done some research, we'd upped our game. We discovered that there are, you know, YouTube videos and helplines and blogs, and many, many, many people have done it before us. So we'd bought proper gear, panniers, we'd bought better bikes. We flew to Passau in Germany, which is near Munich, and then cycled to Vienna. And it was a lovely time because we had more money, so we could eat lots of German sausages and drink lots of German beer. And when we got to Vienna, we could go see the opera. So it was more of a holiday style trip, but it still had that adventurous spirit to it. We still wild camped and we still brought far too much things than we needed. We had probably like more spare clothes than you could ever need if you were going anywhere, but we thought we'd bring everything. And that trip was really fun, because I guess the it was just a bit easier and we'd have more experience. And the more experience you have, the more you can grow and develop your skill set to enjoy it more. I think that's often quite important.
Absolutely. Like you say, it's a saying I use a lot with children, and I've used it in the military, which is poor prior preparation equals piss poor performance. Everyone knows that saying. Well, a lot of people know that saying. So I think being prepared for something like that, it, in the grand scheme of things, compared to your big sort of touring, cycle touring, which we'll talk about in a minute, is very small. As in, was it, again, that was about 10 days or so, the Germany to Austria trip. Did you sort of take anything from both of these trips, and realize how different or similar they could have, would have been, or was, compared, you know, as
Yeah, I
in
think
Australia and Germany?
We definitely grew from the Australia trip. So the Australia trip was probably harder because we were just learning about everything all the time. We'd you know, it was the first time we'd been invited into people's houses and the first time we'd kind of been realized that cycling makes you really, really hungry. And like we developed our skill set to move forward into the European trip. And again, it was only 10 days, but by being in a better position from the fundamentals, so we're probably a stronger team on the second trip because we weren't discovering each other's cycling momentum and hunger pains and just learning about this new world separately but also together. Whereas when we did the European trip, we were probably a tighter unit. Not to say that we didn't have arguments, because sure we did, but it was we'd taken a lot of the lessons we had learned and then reapplied it into Europe. And what's quite interesting is Europe is actually quite easy, whereas Australia, whilst they speak English, it's sometimes culturally very different. Whereas Europe is, in terms of it sees a lot more tourism, so you often you don't get invited into places like you do in Australia. And you know, you've got more of a setup of campsites and restaurants and lovely bars by the big river there. I can't remember the name of the river. Not very
Is that the Danube?
bad. The Doom, yeah, thank you, Dan.
Yeah.
It's a big tourist industry, so like it's really it's set up for bikes with touring. You see maybe 10 or 15 or 20 people on a bike every day cycling up and down the Mark cycle path, which is the Dono cycle path.
Yeah, so did you do a lot of training for that, or was it kind of just off the cuff?
No, we did no real training for that, other than we did no real training for either trip, in fact. We should, well, we should have learned to do some training, but the good thing about cycle touring is if you can kind of set your daily distances on the road. So whilst both of those trips had an end date, so in Brisbane we wanted to get to a music festival, and in Vienna we wanted to get to Vienna, see the city, and then fly home because we had a flight booked. So you can't say, oh, I'm going to stop here for 3 days, because you have to get to the end point. But you can set your daily distances in a way that, you know, if you want to stop, you can. As long as, you know, if you can look at the maps and go, I've got 60 kilometers to do today. Oh, maybe we'll do 40 today, have an early day, and then do 80 tomorrow. That's okay. And you can you can judge it on the fly. So whilst we didn't do any training, I feel that we were able to get fit as we rode, and we were fit enough to make the distance from the very beginning.
So obviously that brings me on to, was it in May 2015 is when you went on your around the world trip. Now obviously you must have learned quite a lot from both of them trips previous. Did you do sort of smaller trips in between, like maybe in the UK or anything like that before you went on this trip?
Yeah, there's two schools of thought, Dan, I think. And there's some people who are planners, and then there's some people who aren't planners. I'm definitely not a planner, right? So I wish I could tell you we did loads of little trips around England. I wish I could tell you that I'd worn clippy shoes for the first time before I left. I wish I could tell you I rode a bike with all the luggage on before I left that first day, but we didn't. We just piled it up and off we went. It was bloody hard.
I can imagine. So for people that don't know, do you want to give people a brief sort of insight to what the actual trip was, and then we'll talk about it a bit more in detail?
Yeah, I guess the overview of that was a around the world cycle ride with me and my then partner Fanola from Reading in England to Reading in Pennsylvania. So Reading to Reading, why? Because I thought it was funny, basically. I thought I'll go to the other Reading. All right, nice one. It was a journey of 46,500 kilometres across 39 countries on about £6 a day in terms of the budget, and bikes that we'd bought, both of us had spent about, mine was £90, I think hers was 120. So minimal outlay to beginning. So it was all about the actual adventure, but that was the trip.
On sort of as an overview, people could probably not compute that in their heads. That's for, like as you say, for someone who doesn't plan anything, like that's quite a big, well, it's not quite a big, it's a very big sort of event. So for the beginning part of it, so when you set off from Reading, which kind of way did you go, and how did you get there?
So going east. So you know, when we say we didn't do any planning, I did do a bit of planning. I bought a large map and I drew a line from Reading all the way around the world. And that was the level of planning that we did. So we went east, and from Reading across into London, and then down to France, Dover to France, and then across Europe, France, Belgium, Holland, Germany, and then into Czech Republic, Slovakia, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, and then into Turkey. So that's kind of our route across Europe, and that changed on the fly because originally we wanted to go down through Austria and Croatia and Montenegro, but by the time we'd got to Germany, we're realizing we were spending far too much money because we didn't really have a lot of money. So hence the bikes are really cheap and how we were living quite frugally, but within our means, you can cycle as long as you eat, you can travel. But so we changed it in Germany to go into the Czech Republic because it was a bit cheaper, and Slovakia and Hungary, cheaper countries than say Croatia or Slovenia.
Then with obviously going through these type of countries, obviously I would say they're pretty standard, as in they're very much like us. They're quite high, not high class, but they're very what's the word, that they live a similar lifestyle to us.
They're Western countries.
Westernized.
Cultural identification.
Yeah, exactly. Now, obviously, as you went further east, as you would have gone through sort of parts of through Asia, did you notice a big change in the way that people would like approach you, or in the opposite term, maybe not approach you and thought you were some strangers or weirdos on a bike?
I mean, there's often a curiosity, and yes, we are strangers and weirdos on a bike, but as you go east, what you realize is that the shackles of humanity are released and people only ever want to welcome you into their homes. I think that is more prevalent in Muslim countries than anywhere else. They do see you as a gift of God, and it is almost a fight between which person in the village is going to let us stay in the house and share dinner and breakfast with us, which is really, really amazing. And, you know, I remember crossing into Romania, actually, and I was still quite at a British mentality. So someone would say, hey, Tim, do you want to, I'm just going to turn this heater off, sorry.
It's all right.
So I was just crossing to Romania, and they would say that, Tim, do you want to come into my house and share a cup of tea? And I'd be like, oh, no, I don't want to put you out. Sorry, no, have a lovely day. See you later. And what they really wanted to do was actually just share in the journey. And it's really important that you let them do that, because both people then win. It's not a case of they're just doing it to be nice. They're doing it because they want to. And that mindset really took me a while to get into. And it was only in Romania, I think, was the first time where I was like, no, I need to be better at saying yes to things, because, you know, it makes it better for both people. I'm enriched and they're enriched, and they want to help, and you're letting them into the journey. And it's a really lovely thing to see. And it only continues, it happens around the world, but it's more prevalent in the countries that are not as rich as we are here in England.
It's going back to what you were saying earlier about in Europe, it's kind of normal for people to cycle, to touring cycle and stuff like that. So I suppose when you were going through these countries in Europe, then people wouldn't bat an eyelid to it. They'd just be like, oh, some guys on a bike. It's nothing to them. But if you're going through quite desolate places and like you say, into sort of like going towards Asia and sort of Eastern Europe, it's probably not as common to see, you know, some pasty British guy going through on a bike. And obviously they're a bit, like you say, they're a bit more curious to what you're up to. Now, obviously you said, like, obviously there's a majority of people were quite kind, but did you ever get like people who were the opposite? Like, did you get people who were quite nasty or just very aggressive or anything like that?
Surprisingly not. So, I never got attacked or robbed. I did meet people who were poor or drunk and would ask for money quite aggressively, but nothing that ever turned into violence. A firm no would let them know that it's, you know, and that's fair enough. You can ask, you know, and if you're drunk, you might ask a bit aggressively. Okay, that's fine. But I had a few things robbed off the bicycle. But that's only when I left them with the bike and then I disappeared. So in Thailand, someone stole my power bank. In Uzbekistan, they stole my MP3 player. And in Chile, the bike was parked up outside a supermarket. I wanted to buy some bread or something. I came out and my whole pannier, all the contents had disappeared. But I think because I'd been on the road at that point 2.5 years, everything just looked minging. And I found it all dumped by a bridge. I just ran a corner. So I was like, oh, that's a relief. It got my stove. So my most important thing is my stove. It's a really lovely MSR Whisper light. It creates a lot of soot when it burns. So I think it just really just looked like an old bag of sooty ash, and he left it by the bridge. And I was very relieved to get it back.
Yeah, I can imagine. So you mentioned that you lived on sort of £5-6 a day. Now, that to me, obviously, I'm looking at it as a outsider, as someone who's not kind of in the adventure sort of, who's not kind of adventurous themselves. That doesn't seem like a lot of money. How did you kind of keep that, like, how did you get that to spread for that long? Like, as in,
do you know what, it's hard because you have to make sacrifices. So when you have a budget and you have, you know, it's very easy to live on £5 a day, like when you're cycle touring, because essentially all you need to do is fuel your body. So you need food, and then your bicycle is free, your tent is your campsite, your wild camp is free, you know, you see everything, you experience everything, you just need to fuel yourself. But the hardest thing is the sacrifice that you need to make. So if you roll into a picture perfect European village and there's, you know, the sun's coming down and you want to have a couple of beers, but the beers are maybe €8 each, it's hard, it's a hard sacrifice to make. So that's kind of how you have to do it to make the budget last and make the money last for the trip. Luckily, in certain countries, especially when you get out of Europe, you can roll into a picture perfect village at sunset and the beer is 50p, so you can have, you can enjoy that process. But it's all about sacrifice. And you know, we didn't have rich jobs, we had basic jobs. I was a travel agent at the time. Finola worked for the Thames Water and the complaints department, so we didn't have much savings to go on. But it doesn't matter how many savings you got, if you're away for 2-3 years, even if you've got quite a big pot, that will dwindle quite quickly.
Yeah.
And it's quite interesting, like countries you assimilate, like, so you think Australia, oh, that's expensive, right? $10 a beer, $40 a night in a hostel. But Australia was really cheap for me because it was so expensive, I didn't spend anything. So I just camped in my tent and ate pasta and rice and oats and occasionally bought a beer, but it was very a cheap country. Where you think Vietnam, dirt cheap, 10p a beer, £5 a hotel. But because it was so cheap, I spent so much because I couldn't appreciate it. So it's only another 10p, bring it on. I spent like £15 a day.
That's a good way of putting it. I think I've not really thought about it like that before, but it's kind of true, like you say, like when you're in these sort of, like you say, Australia, where things are, the similar sort of, obviously people will look at it and they look expensive, but it is relevant, like the pricing, as I've been myself, but like I've not been myself, but I know people who've been like Vietnam, and like you say, they're 10p a pint and stuff like that. But then you've got a tenner, that's just ridiculous, like that people, you will buy more, you just want more, which is kind of makes sense in a way. And that's just the way I think we are as westernized sort of Europeans, especially
you look at it as a bargain, you think, oh, this is a right bargain, I'll have 10 of them.
I don't know,
I'm not really good at saying no to things.
I'm terrible at stuff like that. One thing I was gonna, because Did you acquire any sponsorship by you, or any sponsors at all?
Do you know what? I sent some emails before I left, but I don't really like asking for things. As I said before, it's not really in my nature to say, can I have something? So I sent a couple of emails, but I didn't get a reply. So I just thought, no, I'll do it off my own back. And so we saved, and then we used the savings for the trip, and we bought our own gear on a budget off eBay. So that worked really well, actually.
Yeah, it's very interesting. That's why, you know, another reason why I wanted to chat to you, because just going back quickly to like people like James, who was kind of the opposite. He obviously acquired quite a lot of money in his sponsorship, and that was he's always told me that was the hardest part, was getting to the start line. But it's very different in the way that you just thought, well, I've saved up my money doing my normal job, I'll just go and do it off my own back. And I suppose like that gives you I wouldn't say different motivations or goals, but it gives you a variation on goals and strategies, because you're basically using your own money then. So that must have been a bit different than people like James who used, you know, got sponsored by big companies.
Yeah, I guess there's, you know, cycling around the world or cycling in general is actually quite affordable in a way that some of James' adventures are much more expensive, like climbing Everest or rowing oceans or on the gyrocopter, say. They're very expensive things to do, so you probably do need to find some sponsorship or have a lot of money to start with. Whereas cycle touring, you can, over a, you know, a couple of years, you can save enough money to go away for a couple of years. And also the setup costs are very low, so you don't need any fancy equipment, which makes sponsorship not something that you need to seek out. So I've never done anything that's been sponsored, but I have heard that getting to the start line with the sponsors is always the most important, the most difficult thing, because you're faced with rejection all the time, and asking for money is really, really, really hard. Also, I've heard that you lose some freedoms potentially if you're sponsored. Now, I don't know the experience of that, but that could possibly be a negative to, because you have to support your sponsors throughout their journey, whereas I was just bimbling around.
Yeah, I can understand it. I can understand that. Like you say, when if you've got sponsors, you have to obviously go down some certain PR routes, and you've got to make sure you're constantly updating people on certain, you know, certain times of the day and certain times. So I can understand how that's like the pressure of that can make it slightly more negative. But as I say, in your case, it was on your own back, and you just kind of did it yourself, so you didn't have to please anyone. Except for myself, obviously, just getting on and doing it. It's one thing. It obviously it was going to bring me on to is, obviously, we talk about a lot of it being quite positive. You didn't really suffer anything quite negative, but I wanted to ask you about something that I think you probably must have been quite significant, which was your accident. Like how, if again for people who don't know, how would you explain that? What happened?
So I was in El Salvador, and at this point I'd cycled for about 40,000 kilometers. So nearing the end of the trip, in fact, you know, going north through Central America into the US. And I'd been in El Salvador for 2 days, and I was a bit nervous at the time. But, you know, I'd cycled in Honduras, and I thought that would be scary, but that was lovely. So I took that experience, and I was really enjoying the first 2 days of El Salvador. I'd stopped and had some lunch by the side of the road, a banana sandwich, because I was being real cheap. And I got back on my bicycle and started cycling. And then I was going along, and the next thing I remember is a screech of brakes behind my rear wheel. And I look around and I see a blue pickup truck inches from the back of my bike. And that's the last thing that I remember. So I was obviously hit by the truck. And the next thing I remember is being on the pavement, looking up and seeing a policeman and a lady there. And I was very dizzy and confused, but I knew something had happened and just said, hospital. And the policeman went, yes. And he put me straight in the back of a police car, didn't wait for the ambulance, and drove me straight to the hospital in San Miguel, in El Salvador, where I was busted up real bad. So my head was wide open, so you can see my skull from the front of my head. I've got some really good pictures in the book. And I was in hospital for 10 days. It was real bad. Like the British embassy in El Salvador had to call my parents in England to let them know what happened, because obviously I was on my own and no one knew where I was. I spent the first day, 5 days in hospital just alone. And it was really horrible and really lonely and really depressing. And I was quite scared, and it was a horrible thing to happen. But, you know, looking at the positives, I hadn't broken a bone. So whilst my head had been banged open and they suspected I had concussion, I always say I've either got a thick skull or a small brain, because yeah, the old brain was all right, luckily. And I was able to be released from hospital after 10 days, still, you know, not feeling very well in the legs, but nothing had broken so it would heal. And then I spent another 10 days in a hotel in San Miguel, recovering. And then after 3 weeks from the incident, I was back on the bicycle again. So I was very, very lucky. There was people in that hospital ward. So I was in a room of 6 beds. The guy across from me had his little finger cut off in a bar fight with a machete. It's just a really interesting story. And two other people in the same ward had been hit on their bicycles by cars. So, and they were in a lot worse state. Both of them couldn't walk at the time. So I was very lucky, touch wood, that I was able to get back on the bike. But it was a horrible thing to happen.
Yeah. It's obviously going from that, obviously being a very kind of negative impact on the trip. How did you find the motivation to go and do the rest? I know, obviously, you say you only had about 5,000 or 6,000 kilometers left. How did you find the motivation to carry on? Because I know some people would probably think, well, I probably don't want to experience that again, and I wouldn't want to be in that situation again. So how did you sort of motivate
It was hard at the beginning. The embassy called. They said, "What do you want to do?" And I said, "I want to go home. I don't want to be here anymore. What am I doing? I'm out on my bike in the middle of nowhere on my own. Where all my friends and family are back home. Am I selfish? What am I doing here? Am I seeing anything new?" It took a lot of soul searching to work out what I wanted to do in that hospital. And I guess stubbornness is a big factor. And I just knew that if I did leave El Salvador, I probably would have finished the trip. And I guess I'd come so far that the desire to finish was in touching distance. It's still a long way, but it was, you know, percentage wise, a small percent left of the 3 years. So I thought I wanted to continue. Now, when I first did that first cycle back on the bike with my gear, leaving the little hotel in San Miguel, I was really scared. And one thing I didn't realize and didn't factor in was the post-traumatic stress syndrome that you have, the flashbacks to the crash. I went to a T-junction and I probably sat there for 5 minutes before the place was completely clear of cars and I would pull out. And it took a long time to build that confidence back. Like the first day I did 20Ks and was slow, and my bike was I had a new bike because my old bike got busted in two, so I couldn't cycle that one anymore. So I had to get used to that. And I cycled 20Ks and then booked another hotel because I wasn't ready to camp yet. And it took me, I just built myself up slowly. So the following day I maybe did 30K and booked into another hotel. And then I did 30K again and then 50K and then felt better. And I think after 7 days of cycling a little bit and then getting a hotel, I decided to camp. And that night I slept so soundly again in my tent, and I woke up without a problem at 7 o'clock in the morning, but I knew I was going to be okay. And whilst I still had the flashbacks and the PTSD a little bit, I kind of had a little bit of my mojo back and was able to continue. I was very thankful that I had that.
That's good. It's good. Like you say, I think if you'd have just stopped there and not gone, you know, just come home basically, I if that was me, I personally would have just regretted it. And like you say, it was probably a good thing that you did carry on. I'm gonna hazard a guess that was probably one of the lowest points of your trip, if not the lowest point of your trip.
Like the it was very weird. It was low in the hospital, but the overall experience wasn't low because I was looked after very well by the El Salvadorian police, the British embassy, and the hospital staff. So whilst I was quite lonely, very dramatic incident, but it wasn't probably the lowest point of the trip.
So on the flip side then, could you pick a point out that was probably your most sort of highest point on the trip itself? I can understand that probably one of the highest points would have been when you got home, and that, you know, so people that, you know, watched your journey, but I mean actually on the trip itself.
So there are many roads in the world that are so beautiful that I could never picture. But that's, you know, you can, Kyrgyzstan and Georgia and Romania and these countries are just filled with the most beautiful cycling. It just fills my heart with absolute beauty. But I guess the trip wasn't about just natural beauty. It was about humanity. And so one of my favorite stories was actually in China, and I was cycling in China and I was actually a bit sick of China. China's really big, and I'd spent a whole month cycling across the west side of China, and there's nothing there. I don't know why I bothered doing it. I was just a bit of a stickler for the way, and I wanted to cycle it. And it was every day we'd cycle 100 Ks along a motorway and then sleep underneath the road, and then we'd do it again. And we did that for 1500 kilometers. At that point I was sick of China. I just wanted to get to Vietnam and have a banh mi and a beer. So we're coming down through South Central China, and would like maybe 2 or 3 days before Vietnam we got to this point. And I was quite looking forward to Vietnam. It was coming close to New Year, so I was looking forward to having New Year's in Vietnam. New start, new country, lovely jubbly. 2 days before that, we'd camped along by the side of the road, just like normal. And in the morning, I was lifting up Finola, the bike, in fact, over the barrier that separates the countryside from the road. As I put the bike down, my ankle slipped, and I was in absolute agony. It swelled up real big, and I was like, this is serious. I tried to walk on it, it was too much pain. I tried to cycle on it, it was too much pain. We had 5 kilometres of motorway, or highway, not motorway, but highway to go until the exit. So we kind of, we had to go forward. We couldn't not go forward. And after a real soul searching, Fernando's like, we're going to have to hitch out of this. I was like, okay, who's going to pick up 2 Westerners with massive bicycles? We put our thumbs out. 5 minutes later, a car pulls up, a small sedan, like a Citroen Saxo or something, a real small car. And we're like, they're like, you're right. And we're like, yeah, my ankle's sprained. Can you take me to hospital? And so in the car is a lovely young Chinese couple called Rennie and Rico, and their mum in the back seat. So they're like, yep, what we'll do is, Tim, get in the car, we'll put you in the back seat. Rico, the young male of the couple, got out, and he then rode my bike to the hospital with Fanola, showing her the way, and they drove me to the hospital, which was lovely in itself.
That's
such
amazing.
A moment of pure joy and beauty. But it didn't end there. So we got to the hospital, and this hospital in this village, I think, had never seen Western tourists before. So we were treated like real royalty. So I've given the Chinese medicine on my ankle, and it was x-rayed, and they were like, yeah, you need to rest here for 3 days. And I was like, okay, no problem. I missed New Year's, but you know, I need to heal. Then on the first night, we had a party in the hospital. Rennie and Rico and their mum came back to bring us gifts. The following morning, the hospital manager came and woke me up and said, Tim, we're taking you for breakfast. So we went for breakfast every morning at a restaurant. They then took us for dinner every night in a restaurant. This is like a guided tour. And then they took us for an actual city tour in their little car, showing us the sights and sounds of the city. And then after 3 days, when we left the hostel, I say hostel because it was like that experience. We left the hospital, they're like, okay, we're going to have a party for you before you leave. And everyone brought us gifts, and we had like food in the hospital. It was such a warm and lovely experience. Selfies were taken. Everyone from the security guard to the nurse and the support team were there taking selfies. And then I said to the hospital manager, I said, okay, I need to pay you for this. You know, I've been here for 3 days. We've had breakfast and dinner every day. How much do I owe you? And they said, Tim, don't worry about it. Just pay for the x-ray. $15, I think it was. And it was a lovely experience. Even though like the last two months or so, I was getting sick of China, it maps now my memory of China. And that's such a warm and lovely experience to have and to share with them. It was fantastic.
That's amazing. And again, it shows sort of the kindness of strangers. And from people I spoke to on my podcast, it very much seems like people outside of Europe fall into that category more than they do in Europe. Because as I say, people in Europe are very much the same as what we are. We're very kind of used to people just cycling. Like if you see someone cycling around, say Reading, where you live, you just, oh, they're just cycling. That's just what they're doing. Same for me. If I see them cycling around where I live, they're just training or they're just going out for a trip. But obviously, people that cycle around parts of the countries that you've been to, in say particular parts of Asia, it's not normal. It's especially to see 2 Westerners cycling. It's not normal. So, like you say, it's sharing experiences and curiosity.
Yeah, I think the difference is that the bike is fully loaded. So there's lots of people cycling everywhere in the world. I think it's not the bicycle itself, because the bike's actually quite a leveling playing field. You find this anywhere you go, people will cycle. But it's the fact that you've got all your stuff on the bike, and the fact that you're clearly a European person is what makes it more interesting than the bike. But
yeah,
I think by having these experiences, by sharing these experiences, I do hope that it now, that mindset does change in Western Europe as well. Like, you know, I'll often try, and if I see someone on a fully loaded bike, I'll stop, and if I've got some food or something in the car, I'll give them a snack bar and cheer them on. Even if they're just going 100 miles, it's that same mentality and that kindness that I remember, and I hope people share that. And the more it happens, the more it gets passed on.
Yeah, absolutely. So after 3 years, obviously over 3 years of your travels, 46 and a bit 1,000 kilometres, you've obviously finally got to where you're going. was there, like, obviously by that point, I'm assuming that there was a bit of a story about you and who you were and what you were doing, or was that not the case?
A story is in like a media or a press story, or do you mean?
Yeah, like someone, like people will say, oh, this Tim, he's been cycling from, you know, from England, this, that and the other.
I mean, there was a little bit of press coverage at the beginning, so, you know, I was on BBC Radio Berkshire and the local newspapers to promote the trip. But I guess you've been away for so long, people do forget about it, other than the family and friends. You know, I didn't really have an Instagram or, you know, I did have a blog, but I wouldn't write on it very often because I was too tired or too knackered from cycling. So, you know, this was 2015. I wasn't really a techie person. I kind of better now, but still not very good. And yeah, I guess the only people who really knew about it were my family and friends back home who were actively following me, and maybe a small following, but I didn't really promote it in a way that I think people do now. And sometimes I regret that because maybe I would have a bigger following now, but then I'm like, well, that wasn't the trip. That wasn't what it was about. It was about the cycling and the seeing. So, you know,
yeah,
it's an interesting split of mindset, really.
Yeah. So when you got to Reading in Pennsylvania, like, what was your sort of welcoming when you got there?
So my original plan was, in the very low-key way that I think I embraced life, was to cycle into the town centre, take a picture of me next to the sign, go and find a bar and get really drunk.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just like, well, I've done it now, I'm on my own, I'll get drunk. But luckily, and it was much more beautiful than that in the end. So what had happened is that the night before I was due to cycle, I was like camping maybe 25 kilometers from Reading, Pennsylvania. I knew I was going to cross the line the following day, no matter what. My phone rings, bim bim, and I got a text from my dad. Well, what time are you going to finish tomorrow? I'm like, I don't know, midday or something. Where are you going to finish? And I put town center. He goes, no, where exactly? I'm like, what do you mean, where exactly? And he goes, I'm just asking. I'm like, all right, so I Googled it, like, where's good to finish? And Reading have got this big pagoda. Weirdly, they have a Japanese pagoda in the middle of Reading, Pennsylvania. So I was like, right, I'm going to go to the Japanese pagoda. And he's like, okay. So my mind starts worrying. Why is he asking? Is he here? Oh, I don't want to think about it. Because, you know, you don't want to be let down. You don't want to get your hopes up and then realize you'd finish your trip on your own. And at the same time, if my parents are here, you want to keep that emotion real. And, you know, that I don't want to expect that they're here. So I put that in my mind, and then I'm cycling into Reading, and I'm a bit late, so that would obviously be stressing my dad out if he was there. But so you cycle up this into the centre of town. I was very happy. I've been taking the pictures all the way, 5Ks to go, picture, 2Ks to go, picture, crossing the line, boom, Reading, Pennsylvania, picture, climbing way up this little mountain hill, about 200 metres up to the pagoda, and I turn the thing, and there's a photographer there, and I just smile, and I go, this is amazing. And then my mum and dad stood underneath the pagoda with an American flag and a Union Jack, and just saying, you did it. And it was a really, really nice and touching moment to share that with them, who had obviously been supporting me from day one. And they'd got the local media involved, so my dad had asked the Reading Eagle newspaper, the local newspaper, to come and take some pictures and videos, and they agreed. And I was headline news on that day, which is great. There's probably not much going on in Reading, Pennsylvania. But like, it was really nice finish. And was, you know, we did go to the pub and have a few beers, but it was great to share with them and not just be on my own and share it on my own, basically, which is a really nice way to finish.
That's amazing. Now, obviously, I can see in the background there, you got your book. I just wanted to quickly talk about that. You brought that out, was it beginning of this year? So was it January it came out officially?
February 19th was February. The official release.
Right, okay. Yeah. So, again, for people that don't know what the book's about, it's kind of self-explanatory, Reading to Reading. But it's just sort of like, if you had like 30 seconds to give yourself a little spiel on, you know, people, why should buy it and stuff like that, what would you say?
I think it's an honest and heartwarming book, so it is very much my voice. I've written it and self-published it, so it's definitely it's very honest, and I think it's quite humorous and not too deep, but it is looking at the introspective of bicycle travel, and it is from my journey. So it talks about all the highs and all of the lows. So not just about the beautiful places, but also like breaking up my partner, being hit by the car features, all the wonderful people I've met, losing my granddad while I was in the desert, all encapsulated over 3 years of travel and life, I guess.
That's great. Like I said, I'll definitely make sure that people are, you know, if they want to buy it, then I'll put it in the description and stuff. And most I'm actually going to buy one myself for, just because I think it's a great story. So I'm definitely going to do that for you, buddy.
Thank you, Dan. And just to plug the book, there's two versions of it. And if you are watching this in England, go to my website, timmillikin.com, to buy it there, because it supports me slightly better. And I printed them myself from a company in England, so they're all English printed, and they have colour pictures. So you get to see colour on the inside, as opposed to the ones on Amazon, which, because Amazon have print regulations, they're all black and white pictures. So if you can, buy it from the website.
Okay, yeah, absolutely. That's something I wasn't aware of, but yeah, no, definitely. It's definitely going to be put in the description, and hopefully people will buy it, because it's a great story. There's a couple of things I want to talk about before I let you go. So first of all, like, I talk a little bit about, quite a bit about mental health and stuff like that. And we've already obviously alluded to little bits of like your highs and lows. Now, obviously, you were with your then partner for majority of it, and then obviously some of it you wasn't. Now, how did you keep yourself like sort of looking forward and positive, and obviously when you did have those down days, keeping yourself more sort of in a positive attitude?
Yeah, I think it was really important to just check in quite a lot with yourself to make sure that I was still enjoying it, because yes, you have bad days, but you need to make sure that you are still doing it for the right reasons. You may want to just, so my trick was to ensure, was I enjoying this more than being at home? Because I could always go home. If I wasn't, you know, I wasn't tied to anything, I could always decide to go home. So I'd often check myself and say, Tim, what do you want to do? And I'd be like, I'm still enjoying it more than if I was at home. And that became, because it's really fun, and you know, there are bad times, but realistically it is actually really fun. So the motivation to keep you on the road and keep your mental health sane are the things that drive me personally. Not everybody. I have lots of curiosity, and I love mental and physical exertion and seeing new things around every corner. So as long as those things were being ticked off, I knew that I would be able to carry on the journey. But I was also well aware that if at any point that shifted and I felt like I was doing it for no reason, then I knew in my back pocket that I would just go home. And by having that decision made, that gave me the strength and ability to continue when times were hard, or just make sure that I was still on the right track.
Yeah absolutely. Obviously you've done quite a bit over the years, from what I've, you know, read about you and stuff like that. Is there anything you've got in the pipeline that you can say, or you know, something that's not too sort of intrusive?
No. So I'm very lucky in a way that, you know, I've made my career my passion, as we spoke about earlier. And, you know, pre-COVID, I was guiding a bicycle trip across Africa, which was a big want of mine. And I managed to, luckily is fair, to get paid for it. And it was really amazing. But then COVID hit, and as I'm sure you're aware, Dan, that whole industry got cancelled overnight, and it's been a year of real struggle. And so any future personal trips at the moment, no, because I need to get back working and get back raising the money for anything potential to happen in the future. So there's nothing in the pipeline, but I would love to. There's a few unticked boxes in my life, and that is to cycle the Gibb River Road in Western Australia, which is like a 4x4 track, and it's full of crocodiles and big spiders and remote, and it really seems exciting. Yeah. And I'd love to walk some rivers in Venezuela, because I just feel that the jungle offers so much excitement and danger and beauty and remoteness that one day I'd like to do that. But they're way off in the pipeline. At the moment, you know, I'd be lucky to cycle around Scotland currently. So, like, you know,
Exactly.
It's all a waiting game, I guess.
So, with your future sort of adventures, would you, because I know you've obviously done a lot of predominantly cycling based adventures, have you ever considered doing like the more sort of traditional walking or hiking adventures, or is that something you've not really thought about?
It is, yeah. Like, there's lots of things, you know. I do really enjoy hiking. I've got into hiking quite a lot over the last, few years of my life, and it is a real fun. I've never done really any big hikes. Never done a through hike. I'd like to do the Appalachian Trail. I think that is probably on a lot of people's list of amazing hikes. Also, as I said, I really am curious about the jungle. So any kind of jungle hiking or river walking or things like that really hold a lot of appeal. So one day, perhaps, if I get my skills up, I'm not there yet to go into the jungle. I think that kind of stuff does need a little bit more planning than I'm normally used to. But I would like to do those kind of things. Yeah. In terms of water stuff, I'm not really a sailor, so, or a climber. I don't like heights that much, so I like to keep my things on the ground.
No, I understand with the water side of it. I'm not, I hate kayaking, canoeing and stuff like that, but I'm actually more into heights like climbing, etc. So
Oh, you are, yeah, cool.
So I'm more into that. Last thing I want to ask you, buddy, is something I've asked to most of my guests. As a adventurer, you're obviously self, not even self-proclaimed, I'd happily call you an adventurer, an explorer. Now, if you could pick any trip to go on, so you could go anywhere in the world with anyone, where would you go and what would you do? Now, the one thing I will say is it can't be a cycling one because obviously you've done a lot of cycling. So if you could pick something that's not cycling, who would you go with and where would you go?
Okay, let's go to the Amazon with Ed Stafford. I think he might be bored of it because he's done it before, but he would be a very, very good guide. And I would love to see the jungle with his eyes, and he could show me how to, protect myself from anacondas and know how to survive in the jungle. And I think he's an intelligent and really, like, he's got curious mindset, and I think we'd have really good conversations about life in the jungle. So that would be a really fun trip to do.
That's quite a that, and to be honest, he would probably most definitely be second on my list. So
Okay,
Ed
cool, yeah.
Stafford, he's an amazing guy. Again, if people don't know who he is, you should check him out. He's amazing. He's done all his Naked and Marooned documentaries and stuff like that. He's
He's
amazing.
cool.
And I've said this, I kind of try and mention it on most of my podcasts because I'm hoping one day that he will get in touch or he'll be able to answer an email or something for myself and try and either come on the podcast or someone who I want to meet again, which is Leveson Wood. I'm
Oh,
meeting
cool,
him
yeah.
obviously in October. He's doing a talking event, but he would be my perfect some I don't know what I'd do. It'd be a walking adventure somewhere, maybe in Africa, somewhere like that, because I do a lot of photography, so I'd love to go and do an adventure with him. So hopefully one day he'll hear this conversation that I talk about on the end of most of my podcasts. And hopefully one day he'll get in touch. But I just want to
Sounds
say
good
thanks
luck,
for coming
yeah.
on, buddy. Yeah, hope, I
Oh,
appreciate you
pleasure.
coming on. It's good chatting to you. As I say, it's good to obviously we've talked off camera, and we've found out we actually know quite a few similar people, and we've done very similar things in our sort of besides the trips, the cycling trips you've done. We've done quite a lot of the same things. So it's great to meet you, and I'm sure we can keep in
Oh, you
touch and.
too. Yeah, it's really good. Defo,
We'll
yeah.
yeah we'll I'm sure when we get the chance post COVID or whenever the lockdowns are really not released, but you know what I mean, hopefully we can meet up and we'll do something together. Just for people who want to keep an eye on and keep an idea of what you're doing, what's the best place to get in touch with you or to find out more about you?
My website is timmillikin.com. That's where I do blogs occasionally. I guess the best place is either Instagram, so because I just put pictures up there, which is really easy and people can follow it there. So that's at Tim C. Millikin. Or if you want to reach out and ask me any questions or anything, just email me at timcmillikin@gmail.com and I'll get back to most people. You email me if they have anything to say or just want to say nice one, Tim, which is nice to hear.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you very much, mate. I'll put all the links in the description, so if people want to check out what you're doing, I'll put it in the description and they can get in touch that way. So thank you very much. I appreciate you coming on. It's an absolute pleasure to chat to you. So for people that are, you know, keeping an idea of what I'm doing, obviously I'm doing a lot more stuff in the year to do with my podcast, etc. But if I don't see you soon, then I'll catch you on the flip side.